list of a lot of the most common databases that we'll work with, such as the big three, GenBank, DDBJ, and MBLEP, as well as Uniprot. And we talked about flat file versus relational. How do you maintain a database? Didn't really understand that one.
This one was just an example from a database called TransportDB, which I guess still exists. I'm pretty sure it does. TransportDB. So that's sort of a secondary database that has a list of, it's a relational database, it's got a predicted cytoplasmic membrane transport protein complements for organisms for whose complete genome sequences are available. So it takes complete genomes and predict membrane transport proteins. So it has something like 365 organisms, if you take there's Homo sapiens. So then you find, in this case, you find all the transporters that they have predicted to be there. So they are ATP dependent, an ion channel, secondary transporters, these are and unclassified. And then there are number, each list is the number of families, and each family is number of members. And I guess this is 38, whatever, well, this is some percentage of each subcategory. So you can easily see that in humans, common families are ABC family, and PATPase family, and the VIC family, and somehow the MFS family. So I guess you can click on one of these and get something else, you get a list of all them. And here is the number of transmember regions, etc. So it's a list of, and some information what they are, possible substrates. So they basically have a pipeline for predicting all these features, which I guess we do mainly by homology, just things that are known, but they probably have some other steps in it also. And then they take all the complete genomes they want to have and then run this pipeline. And then there's some other data also. So it's very much integrating data from many different sources. So this is very useful for someone who wants to study transports. And probably some of most of this information probably exists if you go to Uniprot also, because every protein is described there. But this is more systematically classified. It's like if you really want to study just this set of proteins, it's more useful. Okay, so yes, that's.
Yesterday we also talked about this other database, Genome Ontology, but I didn't quite understand what it is.
So Genome Ontology is not a database actually. It's a classification system. Which see if I okay my problem does but so Genome Ontology, I think I have a late lecture about later, but Genome Ontology, so an ontology, it's basically a vocabulary, it's a grammar that describes whatever can be. So if you think about Uniprot or all these databases, they have like subsections of how you classify proteins, because it's what part it is, and is the protein expressed. So is it an enzyme or not an enzyme? And often it was described with keywords, which was not extremely. The problem if you just let people write what they want is that it's not going to be hard to interpret, because people can write enzyme different ways. You can have different interpretations. You need kind of strict rules how you classify things like that. So gene ontology is an attempt to actually classify this type of functional classification of a protein or a gene, That's not the protein can be in. So, so you have, so it's a consistent description of gene products across databases. So it's a way to like classify. It doesn't really contain the functions itself. It doesn't contain the classifications. It only contains how you can classify them. Then there are databases that have it. So for instance, in PFUN, they talk about they have geo classifications of the or the families there. So you can get it. And there are, so the gene products is, it's not a non-trivial, but attributes of selection C are. So basically, it's not the product of, it doesn't contain anything information actually what about any individual protein or individual gene. But it's any individual genes, whatever it does, should be able to describe here. And it's actually divided into three main groups. So basically, we'll talk about more later, but. Maybe a quick there. No, this is just how they get information. It basically has three main categories.
It's in documentation.
Yeah, where is the documentation there? That's
and I think annotation.
Maybe there, yeah. So you have three. One is called biological function. Maybe there.
There's a scheme.
There's a scheme here somewhere. Maybe in ontology. Yeah. So here you have like the top category is stellar component. So that's basically where does the gene act? Is it in the nucleus? It can also be, you know, even in what type of cells, or it can be in the virus particle, or if it's DNA binding in the nucleus. So it's basically where in the cell does it act, and it's, it can be one or several places. It can be some protease in several places, of course. And then biological process, so that's more like in what kind of function in the, is it an enzyme in the metabolic cycle, or is it transcription related, or is it, but it can also be more medical things, it can also be things like a more development or things like that, so it's really more general science. It doesn't really say anything about what is the molecular function, because that's the third category. So the third category is really enzyme, it's a hydrolase, or it's a DNA binding, or it's a transcription factor. So that's really what it does as a molecular component. And then a lot of subcategories. And it's not really as a tree structure, it's a bit of more of a mesh structure. So there are things that can be coupled to several, the networks can go together and things like that. So you have several components. But basically, you have different levels of hierarchies. So if you want to compare to proteins, you can basically take them and see if they are similar, on what levels do they differentiate. And also annotations, you might not know all the details done, so you can annotate as much, you might know that it's a nuclear protein, but you don't know exactly where the nucleus it is, so then you just annotate it as far as you know. So it's systematic things of, I guess it's on-call instruction there, probably. Yeah. So here you have cellular component, biological process, molecular functions, and here you have, for instance, a pigmentation is a biological process, make pigments, whatever drug genes do that. Some metabolic and during development, and then there's a metabolic process. So there are, so every function of that, so there are thousands of these. So that's the genotology. I think we have it more in a later lecture also. So it's useful. It's not very easy to get the overgrip of it, because it's kind of, just because it's, you see that things are kind of coupled in different ways to each other, things like that. So it's not always obvious when you mean the same when you just look at it from first perspective, but it's just because biology is complicated, so it's harder. That's best people can do. It's not easy. It just does this and nothing else. You understand more now?
Yeah.
I don't understand. Yeah. And that eye pigmentation, so eye color is part of biological process that is implementation, but it's also part of the regulation biological processes. Yeah,
so it is like just a classification.
It's a classification of possible classifications, yeah. It's a structure of classifications, yeah. That's what it is. And it's, there are a lot of ontologies, there are ontologies for cell types and stuff, but it's basically a way of describing how to describe biological function, which is not a trivial problem, because you see, really, if you think about eye, how do you regulate the color of your eye, of course it's a biological process, but also it's part of pigmentation, and that's pigmentation and biological process. And I guess it can be a metabolic part. It's there are lots of factors that are, so it's just not an easy way to do it better. And basically, then there are, of course, many other databases. So if you go to UniProt, many proteins there have some GU annotations. So if we just go to my, we took him, see if it's better. And we used to take, put the first one here. And complete GU annotations you have there. So this protein that was unknown has some kind of annotations that are, yeah. So it's a program here called Keywords to Go. So basically, it's some program that takes the keywords that are in UniProt, which is also somehow systemized, and then maps them to geo terms. And then this is transcription templated and regulation transcription DNA templated and regulation of viral transcription. So this is a protein somehow, I think it was unknown, when it does. It only has three terms here. But of course, there are many other proteins with many more descriptions. But this was somehow a putative transcription factor. And that's mainly the biological process, the molecular function. It doesn't really have so much information about it. It's an activator. So that's the keyword. It's not in geotone there. So it's useful for, I mean, yeah, we start talking about functions. Yes, the function is complex and difficult. So that's pretty useful. So what other was the big databases that I thought you should remember? You remember? Didn't I? Which one was important ones? You had the, you said GeneBL, GeneBank, DDBGA.
UniProt,
yes. That's, so UniProt is really, I don't think there are really any good American or Japanese competitors, really. It's PDB, yeah. And PDB is, there is a European version called ePDB or something, but it's basically just a copy of it. I think it's also probably Japanese also, I'm not sure, but you can probably submit it to, it's the same thing there, but it's, at least in all practical purpose, people always talk about PDB.
PFAM
is, yeah. It's a family database, which is kind of, we're talking more about it in a couple of weeks, we talk about protein domains. That's why it is.
Also, you do these higher classification stuff like Omen and K.
Yeah. So, Omen, I don't think we talked about, but it's. That's one of the normal NCBI. So, this is the inherited diseases. Human genes and genetic phenotypes, that's basically diseases mapped to genes. And KEG is a database of, I guess KEG finds something else probably if you search. KEG pathway. So it's a pathway of databases. So pathway databases are always a bit hard, because there are many of them, but KEG is basically trying, if you want to understand, it's one of the better ones at least, there might be others also, but so if you want to have energy metabolism, then you have here, of course, you have lipid metabolism. This is really things that people learn in biochemistry classes. You should know what enzymes are involved there and how things map. And you end up with this kind of nice schedule. So you have the cyclic N-serine and then acetylcoenzyme A, and you have some FAS protein, and then maldodylcoenzyme A, and etc. And you end up with lipid as something related, fatty acid degradation. It was building up, so it's quite complex. But you have really enzyme names there, and it's of course useful because it's often you want to do is of course you want to map every protein to one part here, every enzyme here, so you know what it's doing. And of course, if you look at different genomes, you basically say if something is missing, if you don't, then that indicates that either you miss something in your genome annotation, or you find some other password that is not known, or some other way to do it. But that's very much known from 50 years or 70 years of molecular biology studies that put together. And there are quite a lot of these different ones. Okay, any more databases that did you look for in the lab, maybe? I don't remember what you did.
ON3.
ON3, yeah. ON3 is somehow a of course, PubMed is, of course, I mean, this is genius. PubMed is, of course, is also something people always, here you can do queries, a lot of things. So, things are getting more and more popular, of course, things like variation databases and SNP databases. And, and maybe RNA expression databases. There are a lot of, I don't know what they have here. Should I have something? And here, an ontology of all the PubMed indexing. So, I guess that's just PubMed. So, of course, PubMed is something that everybody uses for this literature. Just basically, it's getting more or less impossible to follow literature, but at least if you search for something, you find it. So, if you search for human genome. Human genome. So human genome, you find 107,358 papers they contain at home. And they are here normally they are just sorted by date, I think. But there is some My PubMed you can log in and search other things. That's even Google Scholar is pretty good sometimes. So and they're often, if you look, even if you take on paper here, they have often links to. It should be. It's plus one. It should be linked to the paper. But it was not. For some reason. No. So normally it's a link up here to the paper. I think it might be that it's just too new or something. It might be that they haven't got it up yet. Sometimes the abstract appears before the. It might be that these things are too new. The last, was the first paper on human genome. So that was in 1965.
That might not have
the same page. Well, how did you find it? It might be a scanned copy of it. So, well, I have no. Should be able to load it. I thought, yeah, well, most of the things you get from Stockholm University you can log in, but maybe because I'm not connected to the real network, I can't do it. Let's log in. Classic but science like. So yeah, this is really a scan of it. This is a. They don't have it in computer format, this is someone had a physical copy of it in scanner. So, anyway, a lot of things exist there. But so that of course, it's not. PubMed is very good for finding deep paper you want to find. So if you want to just search literature, it's just too much, and you can, it's hard to set up keywords to search. But if you want to know what was one paper, you can do it. Otherwise, it's better to go. Obviously, good things to do is to go through things that are linked to reference by others. So many of the new papers you have links to references and things like that. So actually, Google Scholar I kind of like. It's kind of good. Okay. Anything else we did? So did you do the lab? So, okay. So that's, I think, we can then maybe move on to the lecture. Let me just type divide this.